Hey, while you find your way back to your seat, would you say thanks to these guys for leading us in worship? It was great. They'll be back in a minute. And we've reached the point, moms and dads, where you guys can be dismissed through those back green doors. And there's two more sets of green doors. And then you're going to go over to Building A with my good friend Eli Harkey and my longer friend, Pastor Kirk Freeman, right there. And they've got a great evening planned for you guys. Be able to answer some of your D-Now questions and be able to pray over all of us that are in here. So moms and dads, you're dismissed. And guys, since it's our 10th D-Now, we were going through some old stuff. And I found a video. You're going to meet some leaders that you may or may not know here in a few minutes or on Friday night. And so I found an old video that we're going to use in a new way just to help you feel comfortable if old people ask for your phone number. Would you roll that video?
Through ocean, well, don't ask me, I'll never tell. I look to you as it fell, and now you're in my way. I trade my soul for a wish, pennies and dimes for a kiss. I wasn't looking for this, but now you're in my way. Your stare was holding, ripped jeans, skin was showing. Hot night, wind was blowing. Where you think you're going, baby?
Hey, just met you. And this is crazy. Here's my number. So call me, maybe.
It's hard to look right at you, baby. But here's my number. So call me, maybe.
Hey, I just met you. And this is crazy. But here's my number. So call me, baby. And all the other boys try to chase me. But here's my number. So call me, maybe.
You took your time with the call, I took no time with the fall. You can give nothing at all, but still you're in my way. I beg and borrow until you have foresight, and it's real. I didn't know I would feel it, but it's in my way. Your stare was holding, ripped jeans, skin was showing. Hot night, wind was blowing, weird, think you're going, baby.
I'm sorry. Can you start it over again?
Yeah.
I misunderstood. I thought there was no singing when the words started.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is she not singing right now?
Now she is, but it wasn't at the very
beginning. Okay.
Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy, but here's my number, so call me maybe. It's hard to look right at you, baby, but here's my number, so call me, maybe.
Hey, I just met you, and this is crazy, but here's my number, so call me, maybe. And all the other boys try to chase me, but here's my number, so call me, maybe. You came into my life, I miss you so bad, I miss you so bad. I miss you so, so bad.
Oh, you came into my life, I miss you so bad. I miss you so bad. I miss you so, so bad.
It's hard to look right at you, baby. But here's my number, so call me, maybe.
Hey, I just met you. This is crazy. Here's my number. So call me, maybe. And all the other boys trying to chase me. Here's my number. So call me, maybe.
Boy, you came into my life. I miss you so bad. I miss you so bad. So call me, maybe.
My favorite part is that Joey just stops. But if some old people ask for your phone number, that's okay. In this one instance, because you're going to meet some adults who we call life group leaders and some small group leaders that will be with you this weekend. If you don't know what that is, just be waiting for it on Friday night. We'll have our first time together in what we call a life group in a host home. And we're excited about those times as we talk about what God's doing in our lives, as we talk about the scriptures that we read together, and more importantly, we talk about the way we're hearing God and in what we're what he's asking us to do and how he's asking us to live differently. Because that's really what we want to be about. We want to be about reading the Word of God together in this setting. And then when we move to our life groups, seeing what God's asking us to do to live differently. Because here's the deal, guys. What you can know about the Bible, whether you have one or not, is that God still speaks today. And we're, our theme this year for D Now is the word untamed. And I don't know if you exactly know even what that word means, or I'm pretty sure you don't know what we mean by that. But when we start this Friday, we're going to be asking a God who is untamed to be in our midst and to lead us and to guide us as we walk through his word together. So we D Now starts tonight, and then we take a break for Thursday and Friday. That's the bad news part. But the good news part there is that if you still want to invite somebody, you can invite a free friend. They just go to ablazednow.com and sign up. We want anybody who wants to be a part of this weekend to be able to be here. We'll be back on Friday nights, like Eli and Jesse said, at 6 o'clock, and we'll kick it off with the Justin Cofield Band, and Brad and Rachel from Far From Ordinary will be with us, and that'll be great. So if you brought your Bibles tonight, find Ezekiel chapter 34. And if you're a visitor or a guest and you don't have a Bible and you want one, come talk to me, come talk to Jesse, who's right there, Emery's right there, and we'd love to give you a Bible so you can have one for this weekend. Because we're going to be walking through some scriptures in this Old Testament book in Ezekiel that help us see a picture of God. And what you need to know is that maybe God doesn't talk the way, specifically the way he did in the Old Testament today, but the pictures of God that we see in the Old Testament, they help us learn a little bit more about his character and his nature, and they help us learn about what he wants us to do in our lives today. And so that's why we'll be walking through these few stories in the book of Ezekiel, and we'll be asking the Lord, what does he have for us? Because here's what I know about you who are in the room tonight. They'll be with us this weekend, 193 students so far, and there might be a few more sign up, there might be a few more leave that won't be able to be with us. But if you want to see Jesse, or if you want to vote on whatever color of hair Jesse will dye his hair, we've got to reach that 200 mark. So you've got Thursday and Friday to see if we can reach 200. We're only 7 away from there. But here's what I know that's a little bit more interesting about you guys, is that there, of the 193 of you, there is represented in this room 31 different schools. That's a lot of schools, okay? There are 25 middle schools and 6 high schools, okay? And so you're like, oh, well, there's more middle schoolers. Well, no, there's actually not. There's 104 high school students and 89 middle school students. Proud of you high school students for coming, inviting your friends and being here. Same for you middle school students. But I'm excited about our times in these days, because what I want you to understand when we talk about this untamed God, you've been living in an adult world that has tried to tame God for a long, long time. You've been living specifically in a part of the United States that tries to give all of us a picture of God that will make us feel better about ourselves and feel better about our neighbors and feel better about just really everybody. And it's not that God doesn't want you to feel good about yourself. We're going to actually see tonight that he does. But what you can't do is you can't take the picture that God gives us in the Bible and like subtract all of the things that are untamable and still call that God. A couple of you know that I have a story in my past. A friend of mine and I used to like to go down to the Riverwalk in the Dallas Cowboys season. And when we would see guys that were wearing jerseys, like in the heyday of the Cowboys, Troy Aikman, Emmitt Smith, Michael Irvin, we'd love to walk up to those guys and say, hey, could I have your autograph? Right? Because they're wearing the jersey that says Aikman on the back. And that's why I'd say, hey, Troy, could I have your autograph? How'd you get from Dallas? The game was today, so quickly down here. Could I please have your autograph? And they'd look at us like, you're weird, right? I'm not Troy. I don't know what you're talking about. Have you been drinking too much? Or what's the deal? And you see, some of us like to take our own picture of God, or maybe because we've been taught that way, and wrap our ideas around it and call that God. And that's a way in which we tame him. And we want to look at these stories in Ezekiel over the next few days that will help us perhaps get a better picture of who God is, and so that we all together can understand a little bit more about his nature. And then when we go to this thing called life group, if you've never been with us before, we just kind of talk about that and we apply it to our lives. We ask ourselves, sometimes we ask ourselves hard questions that may cause us to want to live differently. And so tonight what I need you to know is that when we're in the 34th chapter of Ezekiel, there's really only three people that we need to be concerned about, or two people and one group of people. And the first one is God himself. He's doing the talking. And the second one is Ezekiel. God's talking to Ezekiel saying, hey, go to the people and tell them this. And the third is God's people, the children of Israel, because that's who Ezekiel is going to be doing the talking to. And so in a minute, we're going to jump in to the 34th chapter and just read a few verses. But I did bring something with me tonight to help us just get a better picture of why it's important for us to see what God has for us in the 34th chapter of Ezekiel. And it is a rotisserie chicken. You guys ever seen one of these bad boys at HEB? Some of you are like, yes, my mom picks one of those up way too many times each week for dinner. Well, Jesse didn't eat any of the barbecue today because I've challenged him to see if he can eat that whole thing before we're done tonight. Jesse, would you come on up and grab this? I want you to see. Hey, Andrade, come up here. You just verify that's a whole chicken, right?
Yep.
We didn't hollow it out. Okay, in fact, I'll just hold him up there. There he is. That's the whole thing. Nice and juicy. Are you ready, Jesse?
Yeah.
All right.
Do I go in the kitchen?
Yeah. Why don't you head to the kitchen, and we'll see. We'll check on Jesse a few times and see if he can eat that whole thing by the time I finish these 14 or so verses. So let's jump in together in Ezekiel chapter 34, and we're going to start in verse 11. And so God is talking to the people, but he's saying, hey, Ezekiel, I'm going to say it to you, and you go say it to the people. And you say this, that thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep, and I will seek them out. And I changed the fonts a little bit there for you so you could see that God's talking. That's why it's a big I. He's saying, I'm going to do this. And what is it that he's going to do? Verse 12, as a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so I will seek out my sheep. So if there's anybody that's lost, God's going to go after them. God's a good shepherd that way. And in the end of verse 12 tells us that I will rescue them from all places where they have been scattered on the days of the clouds and the thick darkness. I was a freshman in high school, and I went to Roosevelt High School on the other side of town. And some of you know this too about me, that I was scheduled the wrong lunch the very first day of my freshman year. Any freshmen in the room? You guys, I went from a small little school to this huge big school, and I was given the senior lunch. We had four lunches at my high school in those days. And so I can remember walking down the hall and walking into the room with people that were much, much bigger than me. They had beards and I did not. They had hair in places that I did not. And I was just really in awe. And so I'm carrying my lunch tray around the room and I'm like, what am I going to do? And that was before cell phones. And there was a phone booth in the lunchroom, a real live phone booth. And I can't find a place to sit down. And so I take my tray into the lunch booth and I'm just right there waiting. And I'm just like, I guess I'm gonna eat my hamburger right here. And about a few minutes into that, I hear a knock on the window, and it's my sister who was a senior. She's like, what are you doing? You're not supposed to be at lunch. I'm like, look at my schedule. It says I'm supposed to be here. And she's like, all right, come sit with us. I was lost for a few minutes, and then I was found. You see, some of us can't really understand the untamable God because we don't know that we're lost. We don't know how far it is that we're gone. And Ezekiel, God through Ezekiel is saying, hey, there are people that are scattered to the furthest places on this planet, and I'm going to gather them back. In verse 13, he tells us that he's going to bring them out of the peoples and gather them from the countries and bring them into their own land. And then there's a little bit of more good news. He said, I will feed them on the mountains of Israel by the ravines and in all the inhabited places of the country. And so God's going to do something for his people. And so I think the other way in which we tame God is that we pray to him a lot, but we don't really believe he's going to do it, right? How many of you, if you're really honest right now, you'd say, yep, that's me. There's a lot of times I ask God, but even while I'm praying and I'm thinking, he's not really going to do that. There's no way he would really love me enough to accomplish that for me. He doesn't care about me. I don't even know if he's real. I'm just kind of lobbing this like a softball that's been hit over the fence. I'm just kind of lobbing this up there because that's what people do, but I don't know if he really cares about me. And you see, unknowingly, that's a way in which we tame God. Because God says everything that happens in our lives in this way, it happens through faith, it happens in belief, and God wants to bring us back to him so that not we could eat real food like Jesse's eating a chicken right now, but that we could receive what he has for us. Verse 14, I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing lands. More good news about this untamable God. He said that there they shall lie down in good grazing lands. On a rich pasture they shall feed of the mountains of Israel. And here comes the best part, guys, verse 15. It's a big I because God's talking. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep. And I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord. You see, it's remarkable when you read it with the capital letters, right? God's talking. And he's saying, hey, a minute ago when we prayed for people, maybe you're like, man, I don't know if I should stand or not. Those are the moments that we need verses like these, reminders like these, that God says, hey, if you're struggling with something and you don't know if you should stand and let somebody pray for you, you need to know that I'm an untamable God and that I'm a shepherd of my people. And one thing that I declare is that I'm going to make you rest. I'm going to help you out. But we tame him in such a way when we just kind of like sit on our hands. I go, man, what would somebody else think about me? Chris said, if you're feeling guilty, stand up. Well, you know, I am feeling guilty because of what I looked at last night, what I watched on TV, what I said at school today, but I couldn't stand up because they will judge me. And that's a way in which we tame God. We like put him in a, we make him a little kitty cat and we put him in one of those like carrying things, right? And we're like, man, that's not the God that this is describing. He wants to make you lie down and he's declaring that, but he's not yet done. Verse 16, he said, I'm going to seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, more big eyes, all these things that God wants to do for us. If you're feeling lost, if you're feeling strayed, if you're feeling like people beat you up at school, they talk about you badly, he wants to be the one that takes care of you. But man, we tame God in other ways when we run to other people, other things to get our self-worth, to make ourselves feel good. Somebody said something bad about me at lunch, bad about me in that class, I failed this test, whatever it might be, my parents are mad at me, and we tame God when we go to other things other than his word, other than his voice to gain self-worth, to make ourselves feel better. But you see, Ezekiel's still not done yet. Verse 17, and I will strengthen the weak, and the fat and the strong I will destroy, and I will feed them injustice. And I can too remember being in high school, and this is where I struggled the most. Because I was one of those guys that went to church on Wednesday night, on Sunday morning. We even had Sunday night church back in those days. So we were in church 3 days a week. And my parents worked at the church, so I was in church all three of those days. And I was trying to do my best to live out that to keep my church life separate from my school life. Because I didn't want my friends at school to know where I was on Sunday morning, on Sunday night, and on Wednesday night. And my parents were great parents. I loved them, but they were also the type of parents that said, nothing you can do. You can't do anything on Wednesday night. You can't do anything on Saturday night because you will be in church on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. And so I did my best to keep my church life separate than my school life. But I'm like, what's up, God? I'm doing my best to love you over here. And when I get to school, why is it that I feel like everybody gets more than me? Why is it that I feel like that guy that I'm competing with in this class gets better grades than I? He doesn't even love you. Did you hear what just came out of his mouth? He just cursed you, God. I'd have a lot of conversations like this because I'm like, why, God? And that made me feel weak. Not weak in the terms of how much weight I could lift, but weak in terms of a lifestyle. Because I was just wondering what God was doing in my life. And God says, hey, you tame me when you live two separate lives. And you think I don't have the, I don't sit in heaven and watch what's going on in your life. You think I'm just like Santa Claus sitting up here on a big chair, just wondering when it is that Chris Dillashaw is going to come back over here and ask me to do something for him. No, the Bible says he sees and knows everything. He's waiting to help the weak. And it's going to change here in a second. And it's going to move from some good news to some bad news. But before we do that, hey, Jesse, how's the chicken going? Jesse! He's like feeding his face too much. How's it going, Jesse?
Good.
Good? How much is gone? We're almost done. All right. You keep going, and now we'll look at the bad news. The bad news is this. In verse 17, the tone kind of changes, and he says, hey, as for you, my flock, thus says the Lord God, and that's in all caps because God's using his whole name. Do you remember when you were little? Your parents may still do this to you. You knew you were in trouble if you got all three names in a row. Anybody's parents still do that? Christopher, Andrew, Dillashaw, you better get up off your rear end and take out the trash. Well, God's using the Lord God here. It's a really big proper name for God. And he's saying, hey, here's something that I'm going to judge between the sheep and the sheep. What's the deal? Why is it sheep and sheep? Why is it sheep and something else? Are you going to judge between which sheep is good and which sheep is bad? And the answer is yes. Because we go to school, we live with people, we have people all around us who call themselves Christians, and that's not what they are, right? And that's exactly what Ezekiel is saying. He's saying, hey, don't be confused. God sees and knows everything, and hey, I'm going to judge between the sheep and the sheep. And then in verse 18, is it not enough for you to feed on the good pasture that you must tread down with your feet and the rest of your pasture, to drink of clear water? And at the end of verse 18, that you must muddy the rest of the water with your feet. And so basically what he's saying is, you're making it hard for people to see who I really am. When you tame me, you make it hard for people who don't really know me to understand who they are. You see, the worst thing that could happen in our schools and our campuses and wherever we go on our teams is that you tell people about a God and that's not really who God is. Like you're like, hey man, would you go to church with me? And then here's some pornography at the same time, because that's not who God is. Hey man, would you like to bless the Lord in this worship song? Did you hear this great song? And then blankety blank, blank, blank next. Or can I copy your homework? Or whatever it is that we attach to our Christian, or the way we live our Christian lives. And that's exactly what he's saying, is he's saying, hey, not that if you're a hypocrite, you're going to hell. Don't leave here thinking that. But that there's going to be this division, this judgment between sheep and sheep. And don't think that for a moment that God doesn't see and know everything. We're almost done. Verse 19. And must my sheep eat what you have trodden with your feet and drink what you have muddied with your feet? Therefore, thus says the Lord, he does it again to them. Behold, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you push with side and shoulder and thrust all the weak with horns, till you have scattered them abroad. We're almost done. I will rescue my flock, and they shall no longer be prey. And I will judge, again he says it, between sheep and sheep. And I will set up over them my shepherd, my servant David. And he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd, the last one. And I, the Lord, will be their God. And my servant David shall be prince among them. For I am the Lord, and I have spoken. That last phrase, it's really, really important. It might be the most important phrase of tonight, but also might be the most important phrase over this entire weekend. And we're going to come back to it in a second. Before we do that, I just want to ask you some questions. just to kind of help us prepare for the weekend, I want to ask you a few questions. And this first time, I want to ask you a question. And I just want you to say out loud, literally, to the person next to you, out loud, what comes to mind when you say this? What's the first thing that comes to your mind when I ask this question? So the first question is this. Do you live, remember, are you ready to say it out loud? Everybody need to go ahead and talk just for a second? Yeah, go ahead and say, everybody say yes.
Yes.
Say no. Because they're yes and no questions. So practice yes.
Yes.
No.
No.
Okay. All right. And here's the deal. First thing that comes to your mind. All right. Do you live your life with purpose and meaning?
Yes.
I heard so few no's. I'm proud of you guys. Maybe I should rephrase that. In the current grade that you're in right now, do you live your life with purpose and meaning?
Yes.
Number two, are you living your life in a way that is fulfilling for you?
Yes.
Number three, are you living your life in such a way that it counts for something? Let me rephrase that. Are you living your life in such a way that other people would say your life matters? Number four. There's only four. Are you living your life full of joy and having fun? All right. I want you to remember your answers because here we go. Shh. We're about to check on Jesse for the last time. But I'm going to ask the questions, same questions, one more time. But this time I don't want you to answer out loud because everybody could just say just about anything because you're worried about what people hear. I want you to answer truthfully this time just to yourself as if you were standing before God himself, knowing that it doesn't count for anything right now, but just listen to the question and try to be as honest as possible. Do you think that you're living your life with purpose and meaning? Are you living your life in a way that you feel fulfilled when you go home each day, each night, at the end of a month? You feel like, wow, if I was gone, people would actually miss me. Number three, are you living your life in such a way that it counts for something? That at the end of your life, there will be something to show for it. And last, and the one that I think and I'm praying will change your life this weekend, because people don't often talk about the Bible and an untamable God in a way that's fun and filled with joy. I want to know, if you were honest with yourself, are you happy? Are you living your life? And would it be full of joy? Would people that bump into you say, that's a happy person, or that's a sad person, or that's a mean person? Be honest. You don't have to say it out loud anymore. Be honest. Because here's the deal. An untamable God is a God who wants you to experience a yes to all those things. And most of you find it difficult to answer those questions positively in a yes. Because you've tamed God, or you don't know him at all. Because I walked you through 13 verses that showed you very clearly that he is a God who calls himself your shepherd, your good father. That he wants to take care of you. That when somebody threatens you, he wants to move in. And that to me would be very, very scary. He wants you to be secure, to be safe, to know all those things are true. And if you couldn't answer yes, then you may have tamed your God. Hey, Jesse, you got the chicken finished? Jesse! Is it done? Come on up, show us. Give that man a round of applause. Not really. How much did you get done? Most of it. There it is. But this is really what I was after, right here. Because this weekend, we're going to see a picture of a God who took Ezekiel over a valley of dry bones. These bones are still wet. I don't know if that's Jesse's spit or that stuff or what. But he took Ezekiel up to the edge of the valley of dry bones. And he said, prophesy over those dry bones. Because Ezekiel, I'm going to raise up an army for me and for my glory. And when Ezekiel spoke those words, that you saw the video early, the bones, they started rattling. They came together. They formed and skin was around them. And God breathed life into them. And that's what I'm praying happens for all of us this weekend, that we would meet an untamable God that captures us when we move into worship, when we move into Bible study, to life group, when we're walking down the hallway, whatever it might be. So we want to be in his presence and know more and more about him. Let's pray. God, I thank you that you are an untamable God. And I thank you that we see a picture that I doubt this chicken is about to start clucking at any moment. But a few thousand years ago, at the edge of a valley, at just your word, dry bones reassembled themselves. And you brought them back into life, and you breathed life into them. And so before we meet again on Friday night, I pray over these students that I love that you would breathe life into them. Before we meet for a few minutes in our D-Now groups, God, I pray that you would use this word, this song, to breathe life into us, such that we would be able to answer yes. We'd be able to know an untamable God. In Jesus' name I pray and believe. Amen.
I surrender.
God, we thank you that in you we can find that safe place, that hiding place. That in the midst of a God who the Bible describes as the Lion of the tribe of Judah, an untamable God, that your heart is good towards us. You died, as Ty read at the very beginning of tonight, you desire that none would perish, but your kindness and your mercy leads us to repentance and leads us to experience life. God, I pray that we would experience that even tonight, throughout this next weekend, and that would cause us to just let you be unleashed in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray and believe.